and welcome to BloombergQuint. We're talking about budget 2017, and the question really we're asking today in this special broadcast is whether this budget was designed to repair the demonetization damage, or whether it was designed keeping in mind the elections that will occur in a few days from now. And what about boosting private investment or protecting the Indian economy from global headwinds? Lots of questions about what this budget was oriented towards. And to answer them, we have a stellar panel. Let me introduce all our panelists. Ashok, Wadhwa, Group CEO of Ambit. Rajiv, Anand, Executive Director of Axis Bank. Sajjid, Chinoy, Chief India Economist of JP Morgan. R. Shankar, Raman, Wholetime Director and CFO of Larsen & Toubro. V.S. Parthasarathy, Group CFO of Mahindra & Mahindra, and Rohan, Shah, a well-known tax counsel. Gentlemen, to all of you and to my colleague Ira, a warm welcome. Let me start with you, Ashok, and ask you whether you found there was an underlying theme in this budget of any sort. Was it elections? Was it to protect against demonetization? Did it do enough for private investment? What about global headwinds?
I'd say there were three broad themes. Obviously, pro-poor and to some extent anti-rich. It didn't turn out exactly that way, but certainly a bit of take from the rich and give to the poor. Clearly, there was an eye on elections, and therefore a lot of stuff on affordable housing and how can the poor man really be better taken care of. And I would say government expenditure, particularly towards rural India and infrastructure, government recognizes that capital expenditure from private sector is certainly not forthcoming at this point of time. And therefore, government needs to do whatever it needs to do to kickstart that cycle. So I would say those were the three broad themes, and the government played it well, I would have said.
Okay, let me open up that question to everybody here. If you'd like to add to what Ashok has already laid out, did you perceive the budget in any different light?
Can't say different, but certainly I saw it as a disciplined budget. I saw it as growth-oriented. I saw it as focused on Bharat in a long way. And I saw it as being fundamental first, which basically means there are no big breakthroughs in the budget, but building on whatever has been laid down last year, whether it is even as small as, you know, capitalizing banks in a small way, or even you go to, if you see the rural sector, everything is an add-on from last year. So building on last year, and last but I said, great in intent. And okay in content, so.
Great in intent and okay in content. Sajjid, was it really growth oriented?
So I think the budget, without saying so, was responding to this new global reality, right? 4 months ago, we were all gung-ho about emerging markets, but the fact is, the global economy has become a very dangerous space for emerging markets the last 4 months. So I think the primary motivation here had to be to give the perception to the world that India is not going to trade off macro stability for growth, which was really the expectation. Everywhere I've gone the last 3 months, I've heard about this consumption stimulus post-demonetization. And I think the finance minister did very well. So I think the first lesson was we will continue on a path of fiscal consolidation, number one. Number two, to the best of our ability, we'll protect public investment. The fact is public investment has stayed at 1.8% of GDP. And the third surprising part in the numbers is, despite this notion that there's a lot of spending to the rural economy or expenditure spending or consumption, the fact is current expenditure has been cut by 0.7% of GDP. So actually, on the expenditure side, this is very austere, number one. Number two, on the revenue side, it's quite realistic. Tax revenues are quite budgeted quite realistically. So except for disinvestment, and we'll talk about that later, from a macro perspective, this is as good as it gets. You're doing fiscal consolidation, you are protecting public investment, you're improving the mix of expenditure, and you're budgeting revenues very realistically. It can't get better than that combination. So I think that for me was the overall theme, that yes, we'll try and support growth. There's a huge monetary stimulus underway that we don't talk about, but not at the expense of macro stability, which is exactly the right policy response in a very dangerous global environment.
Yeah, Rajiv, similarly, yeah. Good things to say about the budget? Disciplined belt tightening?
The fiscal consolidation at 3.2%, I mean, you can have a conversation in terms of the math, but I think the fact that the intent is 3.2%, I think, is really good. Two is urban, the fact that there's focus on digital payments, which is really, in a sense, a continuation of all the work that's been done during the process of demonetization, I think is certainly very positive. And of course, the focus on affordable housing, I think, is in a sense, the consumption kickstarter. And I think I'd like to believe that I think all that's been done for affordable housing will start to move that sector which is good for the cement and steel, but also for banks.
Yeah, well, Mr. Shankar, I know we'll talk about infrastructure in much more detail a little bit later on, but big picture view, budget looks good?
It looks good, but I thought it was a bit presumptive in terms of the effects of demonetization. And it did appear to me that the government did believe very seriously that demonetization is behind them. The public has accepted it, and remonetization is sort of filled in the gap. So they were almost dismissive about the effect of demonetization, did not get enough mention. They made it definitely sound like the sacrifice worth making for the larger good. So a lot of time was spent on the larger good. The government did seem to believe that the only way out of this troubled spot is through investments. So the big demographic advantage that we have, the bulging middle class, ability to have a large market, sort of receded to the background, and it looked as though that first they'll have to invest, get the people a little more comfortable on the jobs front, get a little more disposable income in their hands, and hopefully consumption will follow. So trend seems to be that, look, let me invest first and reap the benefits more towards 2019, when it's important to have a public sentiment much better than what it is today.
Okay, quick last word on this first question, Rohan, from you. And it might in fact be, you know, the most extensive answer you have to give, because let's be honest, tax is really not the talking point of this budget, besides what they did with income tax, right?
So thankfully so, right? Amongst all of the many compliments, I think compliments that he's really taken the focus off tax. And, you know, we're now probably in the first time where tax is almost a non-event. And while I sort of endorse a lot of what has been said in terms of what is good, you know, I had one fundamental question, whether demonetization or otherwise, was the biggest issue I think we face is the sustainable, fruitful employment of the youth. And was there going to be anything here which was really a signal in terms of saying entrepreneurship is welcome, we want you to put your money in, because that will create the jobs, which will ultimately hopefully buy those houses, which will ultimately go out and buy a few other things. And from my perspective, you know, while there is a lot of good here, I think that question remains unanswered. And the many more years that it remains unanswered, I think ultimately it will cost us beyond elections, and it will cost us beyond all the things that we love to discuss. Because unless the youth is gainfully employed, I don't know what we really
do. You struck a chord with us, because the BloombergQuint editorial agenda was, where are the jobs? And we thought that that really encapsulated everything that the economy needed to do in terms of being able to create opportunity.
But he did speak about enabling youth,
yes,
to skill themselves up. Yeah. So I think it's also a possible question of, you know, what comes first. Does the employability come in first, and then the opportunities?
Yeah, but I think we have enough evidence, empirical, anecdotal, whatever you want, that the sort of skilling which is done is not creating sustainable employment. And a lot of those figures actually tell you that you train a young man to be an electrician. In 6 months, he gives up because A, the job is 800 kilometers from where he wants to live, and B, that is not where he sees himself for the rest of his life.
We have a trillion such stories, actually. Yeah. If you're on Bloomberg, we've covered all of them over the last few weeks.
You know, interestingly, and in a lighter way, if anything, there is one particular provision that he, and I don't know why they had to announce that, which is quite negative towards being an entrepreneur. So, you know, if you have set up your own business, and you want to now list it, you have to pay capital gains tax. He brought in a new piece of legislation that any investment made after October 1, 2004.
We were just talking about that. Cannot
and which does
has not paid
STT. So, you know, I began Ambit in 2007. I recapitalized Ambit in 2007. And it's interesting, isn't it? Everybody else, if I list Ambit, everybody else who buys and sells Ambit stock will get the benefit of capital gains tax, but the guy who worked hard to build it all up doesn't get the benefit.
So we were just discussing that before we started.
Doesn't get the
impact
benefit.
On ESOPs, the impact on purchasing shares in an IPO.
In a country where wealth, large part of middle class wealth is created through ESOP, you have now, you know, made it less attractive. I mean, you're going to tax people who work for listed companies and who get ESOP for their hard work, because, and you know, at the same time, if an investor comes in, buys the same stock and sells it after a year, he hasn't worked as hard as the guy who's perhaps contributed so much to the company, and these guys get taxed, I get taxed.
It wasn't quite the long-term capital gains tax change that we were all anticipating.
Well, after certainly
the
Prime Minister,
but it is, yeah.
It certainly is retroactive. I capitalized Ambit in 2007, and I will have to pay tax in 2017.
It's retroactive and regressive.
But what's illogical on that is, you know, I can understand that if the tax was attracted and somebody omitted to pay it.
Right.
In which case you say, look, there must be some consequence. The law provides for a consequence, but you want to exaggerate the consequence. But where the event does not attract a tax, then how can you over a period of time say that there is now a disincentive in relation to that?
So yeah, the commentary, if you read the commentary in the explanatory notes, it talks about SMEs, medium enterprises, have utilized the exemption on capital gains to launder money. And I have no doubts that there is, and I know that there is evidence on how non-compliant investors have used penny stocks to launder money. And to that extent, given the sustained attack on black money, it's a right step. But as somebody explained, you can't take a few wrong people and penalize many, many other right people who work very hard.
But it's classic baby bathwater India tax policy, right? I mean, it's classic that. But I must say that before we even proceed further in this conversation, I think the core of what happens to the economy lies in the macro numbers. Yeah. Ira was quite convinced by what the government was doing. I was not, so I'm going to hand it over to
Sajjid
her to talk
has
about
the
that.
Answer to that. I mean, some of the numbers are realistic, right? I mean, the expenditure numbers you're fine with, the tax numbers you're okay with. Is the nominal GDP number looking okay to you? And then also the divestment number, is there something hidden there?
So a couple of things. One is that the nominal GDP number for this year could end up being lower, but you know, that just changes the fiscal deficit at the second decimal level. Next year, 11.75% seems a tad high. But remember, much of this could be inflation. The fact is WPI inflations are running at 5%. So what you might get is the bad cholesterol, so to speak, the deflator slightly higher. So I can live with a number in the 11% handle. I think the only kind of issue here on the revenue numbers is disinvestment. Now, one can look at this two ways. The skeptics will say, we've never done 72,000 crore. You know, how will we get here? I would say that, you know, if you combine this with the fact that they've listed five general insurance companies, or they want to list it, that intention is there. There were two more railway companies. Now, perhaps there's a realization here, and I've been saying this like a broken record for the last 3 years, that the only way to square the circle is to do this asset swap, where we know you need to do much more public investment, but you've got these fiscal targets you have to meet. So what do? You systematically sell the assets you have. And you're basically trading off low productivity assets on your balance sheet to invest in high productivity assets. My sense is some of this is seeping through. Now, there are buffers here. If some of that money doesn't come through, for example, you could still find some resources because of the deposits and after demonetization. And the RBI dividend has been budgeted relatively conservatively. It's 75,000 crore. Normally, the RBI gives you 65 to 70,000. We may end up with 0.1 or 0.2% of GDP. So I think compared to a normal year, the risks here are less egregious, that you will have slippages in some place, but there'll be offsets in other places. So actually, I think, you know, in the last 4 or 5 years, this is one of the cleanest budgets in terms of tax buoyancy and expenditure rationalization.
And they could be at the back of their mind keeping some 50,000 crore kind of number, which could come from a potential RBI dividend. I mean, they can't say
that's right. And I think that will serve as an offset to the fact that if your expenditures slip a little bit because you've got allowances on the pay commission, and or you don't get some of your personal income tax growth, that's budgeted at 25% on the back of a 25% growth, and or the disinvestment doesn't come, you've got something in your back pocket.
I think they have something in the back pocket. Remember that they've said that they're going to list the IRCTC.
Yes.
And if they're going to get e-com kind of valuation for that, I think that's a big check in the back pocket.
It could be that, or it could be the dividend.
They also have a lot of money in the back pocket on tax collections, because you know, none of this has still taken. I mean, if 15% is the generic growth over the last 2 years, and they are budgeting a 15% growth, it's not out of place. But this still doesn't take into account the money that they'll get after, you know, out of the forced IDS that's currently running through.
There's a number there.
I think the economic survey made this point. We need to be careful here. For going after the last 0.1 or 0.2% of GDP, what you don't want is overzealousness on the part of the tax authorities. Yeah. If you're going to, you know, across the board send out notices, that will reverse some of the many important games. The fact that tax is not an issue today, you want to ease doing business. What you don't want is to, for a very aggressive taxpayer, trying to find the last 10,000 crores when there are other ways you can do that. So I think you have to strike a balance here. I think the survey repeated this point again and again.
But you're also saying there's an other borrowings item where they could have hidden this number that they said coming in through the IDS, right?
So I think if you think about financing, that's another issue. The market borrowing was much lower because they're banking on small savings. Providing much more, and they're banking on the fact that some of the money in IDS 1 and 2, some fraction has to lie with the government for 3 or 4 years, so they can use that for market policy. So there are lots of pieces in the air, make no mistake. But I think that, you know, going in today, I thought there'd be much more uncertainty. I think the biggest uncertainty is not any of this. It's the fact that when we transition to GST,
I was just going to say, we're missing GST in this entire conversation.
And I think it's really the what revenues you get in the or don't get in the first 2 or 3 quarters that matter. What was very good is the GST Council has set up a self-contained compensation mechanism. So the central government won't be burdened by higher compensation to the states. The worries of revenues themselves are low. The pie itself is not as big. You know, then what do you do? I think that for me is the first order risk. The rest of it is second order.
You know, you have experience, I mean, at least studied experience of what GST can mean in terms of volatility in revenue in the first year on. They've kept their targets low for indirect taxes. It isn't as if they're very ambitious targets. But are those targets ambitious in the face of the first year of GST?
I think in the context of GST, much of the narrative borders on issues which are probably not going to make the definitive difference. And let me tell you what, to my mind, the definitive difference is. If you want a GST to work, you really need the commercial interdependence of businesses across the whole country to work, which means from the smallest guy to the largest corporation. Because any time that you lose credit in the chain, GST is actually too costly a tax if the credit chain is not robust.
Right.
So the question now is, you anticipate somewhere close to 9 million to some more businesses will actually migrate. Of this, if you see the guys who really have the facilitation to migrate, it is probably 20,000 businesses.
Hmm.
The rest of them, who are really the heart and the core of GST, have absolutely no clue. They have lived with one tax all their life, either it's a VAT, or they have lived with some alternate in terms of excise duty and service tax. None of these people have any sense in terms of where this is going. So that's issue number one on GST, that the absolute core of your GST, the taxpayer doesn't know what GST is. Second, generally the taxpayer doesn't know, the tax administrator knows, and therefore the tax administrator, having the advantage he does, sometimes is a little seen as a little more oppressive or aggressive. Here, a lot of the tax administrators also don't know. Throughout their life, they've administered either VAT or service tax or excise. And now you have some of them protesting to say, the guys who know best how to administer are out of the system because you are abdicating more powers to the state. So if you ask me the challenge of GST, and look at recent global experiences, Malaysia, for example. They gave 18 months in migration, they still have a huge set of issues. Nigeria has tripped up before. We are saying publicly that I will interact with the taxpayer from April, I will migrate on the 1st of July, and this whole body of guys who both have to pay the tax and administer the tax effectively don't have a clue. And that to me is the biggest fundamental hole in terms of your GST aspirations.
So you're saying that any numbers that you put in targeted X, you know, indirect taxes are difficult to believe at this point in time because this is a completely unknown
situation. Because
quite
honestly, at best it's an educated guess, at best, but by and large you just don't have a clue whether the guy who's supposed to pay is going to pay. And look at the registration which they've started. A lot of people are saying, even in the registration phase, I don't want to register. So if you see the situation of VAT registrations versus guys who moved into GST, you have such a large variance at this point in time that unless somebody cracks the whip, they won't register. But registration is not equivalent to compliance.
Yeah.
He exists in the system. Does he exist in the system in a manner that is contributive? Question mark.
Big question
actually,
mark.
Actually, it also talks about online much more than the form era that we're all used to. And it has its own challenges because the bandwidth is still an issue. And we've had enough instances of people complaining that they just don't know how to go around the maze of electronic registration. And the credits, what is being spoken about, is available only if it is seen on the system. Yeah. So ability to upload in time, otherwise I lose the credit and the supply chain.
So one statistic, there's some state one is working with. So today the situation is that do I have a system which is compliant to take any ERP? So can you take SAP, Oracle, Tally, what have you? Okay, so they go out to three industries which are dominant in that state, gem and jewelry, clothing, and auto ancillaries. And they find that in two of the industries, 84% of the accounts are written as a bahi khata, in a red book, in hand. What is the process of that conversion and the acceptance of that data?
Still feeling confident about the macro numbers, I'm asking.
So
I didn't
let me give you a contra, not contra per se, I mean, I'm not taking anything away from what they said. But just from a taxman point of view, just see the today's served market. They have made sure that the served market is going to pay same tax or thereabouts, roughly, each one of them. Now, this says on the so-called 28% equates you to what you are going to pay earlier. Okay, so if they continue to have the served market, from a tax revenue point of view, you are okay. The second one is that there is onus on all the big corporates. That means for the same reason that the credit is going to be only available if my vendor puts in his debit. So that's my credit, right? So when he bills in. And then layer two and layer three. So you are going to find that the bigger ones will have to carry all the smaller ones if that has to happen. So is it going to create a transition issue? Yes. But is it going to be the reason of existence and survival for all the big corporates to carry all the smaller guys? That is also yes.
Okay.
So I think there is a balance here. Transition is going to be a problem, but revenue-wise and you know the early adoption
you
of the bigger ones.
You seem to have more confidence.
Okay, raising revenue is one issue,
but quality of spend is the other one as well, right?
Absolutely. So just housing, I mean, I think both of you would be able to talk a little bit about housing, Rajiv. They've really focused on that sector. It's, you know, no-brainer. Everybody says it has the largest multiplier effect, etc. But this whole affordable housing thing, how well has it worked? Because our numbers show that all these Awas Yojana targets, none of them have been met. Large banks are not particularly keen to this lend to this segment. The NPAs in this segment are higher. So this whole affordable housing push, does it come through like they're thinking it will come through?
So I think the primary issue has been, like you rightly said, I mean, the supply of affordable housing. I mean, most builders don't want to get into that sector. And I think there are a lot of measures this time to be able to drive that. They've also increased the size of the house for affordable housing, so to speak. Which I think is all good. And hopefully will start to drive, you know, people within that sector. As far as banks are concerned, you know, for example, for Axis, we're very active in that. We've got a product called Asha, where we do about a couple of hundred crores a month within this space. Typically, you know, remember the ticket sizes are, you know, somewhere between 10 to 15 lakhs. So the size of that opportunity is very, very big. I think if you look at any of the, you know, sort of macro statistics in terms of the number of people who want to buy a affordable home,
of course, sure.
Is huge. But you know, now we also have data for us to be able to bring in some of, you know, for example, your driver or your maid. We are able to use you know, sort of data to be able to assess their credit and therefore be able to, you know, offer them loans. And I think I do believe that this is a large opportunity, and the fact that the government is focusing on this is certainly positive.
And it also brings some employment opportunity. I mean, not, you know, long-term employment opportunities, but as you get that sector going in the rural areas, you'll probably have some employment.
See, affordable housing, like you know, has been one of the biggest things that we have not been able to break. The reason is it has to be affordable housing has to become at a lower, at a particular cost point.
Yeah.
And how are we going to get to that cost point? So one is the, you know, for example, land cost is different. But building cost, by and large, is not very different once you talk about cement and what you put in. So this has been a very tough one.
So are you convinced by this one crore number?
So just
because
to get...
it looks very good on paper. We all agree it's a priority. But is it really going to get delivered the way the budget imagines it to be?
I think you got a point there. So I'll come back to that in a minute.
Intent and content.
Oh, I know you. So coming back to this, so what is causing this whole thing? Is part of it is the finance cost. Part is getting a new business model to construct it as a low cost. And I think, you know, whether it's Jerry Rao, whether it's Mahindra, you know, rural housing or Mahindra Life Spaces, all of them are trying to get this, break this this particular thing. What has come now as an intent is a shot in the arm, that you are going to get finances lawyer, you are going to get, you know, some way of making it. Now
because
the definition.
Of the infrastructure status. Yeah, because of yeah. the infrastructure status.
Infrastructure status. Because of the tax concessions. Because of the definition of what forms affordable housing. So all of this is very much right into. So I think if I were to take away one thing from it, I'm going to go back and say, hey, Mr. Affordable Housing, can I increase your targets 4x? Yeah? Okay? So that's
this
what I'm going
like
to say.
Yeah,
all right? So that's the CFO speaking.
Yeah, I that.
Having said that, now what is the implementation at the ground level, you asked? So if you asked me to answer that question, I would want to look somewhere else to say, milte hain break ke baad.
Maybe we can look at Sajjid because I know he needs to leave. Sajjid, the affordable housing, I mean, on paper, it's a good idea. But actually, a wider question, did you do enough to actually go beyond demonetization, whether it's repairing the damage or actually trying to get the long-term gains from demonetization, which we'd all talked about? There was nothing on cash transactions, which I'll come to you on that.
Or nothing on infrastructure.
Nothing, you know, major on infrastructure.
A 4 lakh crore number, but I'm not really sure. I mean, Mr. Shankar will weigh in, I suppose, at some point on whether how meaningful that spend is.
But I'll wait for Shankar.
Yeah, sure.
I'll just give the macro view, which is that I think the fact is, last year they budgeted public investment, broadly defined, to be 0.3% less than the previous year, 0.3% of GDP. And all of us said, you know, well, the whole thrust is going. But they seem to have over-delivered. So in the RE for last year's budget, public investment has been maintained at 1.9% of GDP, and they've held it this year. So budget to budget, taken at face value, this is a 25% increase in public investment, which is, you know, if they spend it, would be not enough to offset private investment, but meaningful given the context we're talking about. I think on demonetization, I've had a different view. I always believe these are temporary growth shocks, and policymakers must look through that. And what do I mean by that? All of us worried that the morning after, 30% of the currency would not come back. And that would have been a large negative wealth shock that would have spiraled on for 2 or 3 years. This is a man-made cash shortage shock, right? So some of this demand will be destroyed, but much of this will be postponed. So our sense is that as the economy gets remonetized, you have a two-quarter growth shock, a demand shock, and in the second half of the year, you will get this automatic consumption rebound. If anything, in the medium term, you may get an adverse supply shock, which is to say, by forcing firms in the informal economy into the formal economy, they may not be viable or competitive.
Correct.
But some of that activity may be taken up by cheap Chinese imports. The fact is the rupee has appreciated 10% in real terms against the Chinese currency in the last 15 months. Whichever way you look at it, this is a negative supply shock to the economy, which is fine in the grander scheme of things. You don't counter a negative supply shock with a positive demand shock, because what that will do is accentuate the internal and external imbalances. So for me, the exactly wrong response to demonetization would have been to say this is a two-year shock and requires a large consumption stimulus. Now, this doesn't make me popular, but I think by not doing anything, they did the right thing.
Mm-hmm. I want to know if Mr. Shankaraman feels the same way. Look, the number is impressive. I think 25%, 4 lakh crore rupees, but is it going to translate into substantial investments into large infrastructure?
See, there are two parts to it. One is the affordable housing that we are talking about.
Yeah, we've discussed that.
Which I think would, the success of it would depend on the model that the government uses. In any of the real estate projects, the hidden wealth is in the land. The construction cost could be anywhere, I mean, being affordable, it could be anywhere between 1500 rupees to 2000 rupees per square feet. So who is going to be the developer? Who is going to be allotted the land, and what kind of value add he makes on it would then become a subject by itself. If it is going to get very political, and the way land transactions have happened in the country, then there is a doubt about ability to deliver 1 crore homes. But if you are going to do it in a sterile environment, and like they are saying for the rest of the infrastructure, if you are going to acquire the land and give it out for construction, then it possibly could turn out into a large construction opportunity. Government normally takes comfort in security of large numbers. So the ability to pre-qualify who can construct, because there could be dime a dozen contractors available if you're going to do it in the length and breadth of the country. So you tend to sacrifice on quality. And some of these schemes actually fall on the ground because you've not had any quality standards in in the build-up of these homes. So if the government is going to be bold enough to say that there will be a pre-qualification, not just L1, but on quality delivery standards, then and the land gets acquired in a transparent way and handed over. I do not know about 1 crore home, but substantial progress is possible.
But that's just housing. What about broader infrastructure in the economy?
I was just closing the loop on the
on the housing bit.
In terms of broader infrastructure, what are they talking about? They're talking about the usual roads. They're talking about railroads. They're talking about airports. They're talking about rail stations.
Yes.
And they're talking about safe drinking water. They're talking about solar power. Yeah. These are the major areas and waste
year
management.
Year after year, these have been talking points, right?
Yeah, that's right. But you know, just because the theme gets repeated does not make the theme any irrelevant.
Of course.
In today's context, if India needs to invest its way out of trouble, it has to create employment. And there's no private money available. It's going to be public money. Public money is best spent for public infrastructure. And that is what I think the government is looking
at. Have they done enough is the question.
They've not done enough in the past, but I think we cannot let our optimism die around this. Because it's very important that whatever leads that are being given, we need to take and move on. The biggest bugbear in infrastructure has always been implementation. Now, it's easy to allocate capital and say this is what I want to spend on a sector. But the underlying realities of be it land acquisition, the clearances,
utility shifting. We've seen it with roads and Nitin Gadkari.
Absolutely.
You know, a minister who wants to move really, really fast, but I think has run into all kinds of issues. I know some of our guests are on a TV hop and need to move on to the next studio. So I wanted to put in one question, I know, Ashok, before you left. Whilst we're talking about spends, you know, rural spends, consumption boost, infrastructure, affordable housing, the one piece that seemed to be missing in this budget was anything that sort of addressed the issue of crowding in private investment. Now, is that something that's outside the ambit of budgets that, you know, if you create the right atmosphere, it will happen? Because it hasn't happened so far.
I love the pun. it is within the ambit of budget, I would say so. Listen, I think the investment cycle for a while has been partially injured. At a time when consumption is on a relatively weak wicket, at a time when there is overcapacity around the world, at a time when, in a sense, Chinese capacity is looking at your demand like a hawk, at a time when the world economy is itself inward-looking, I think the sentiment towards private investment is a relatively weak sentiment at this point of time, which is perhaps the reason why government allocated a much larger portion out of its own resources, recognizing that at this stage private investment is not really in a healthy situation. Let's also not forget that government's sustained attack on black money has caused a fierce psychosis, has resulted in, you know, several mid-tier enterprises and entrepreneurs moving out of India at this point of time. And if they are going to spend time outside of India, clearly they're not going to invest money in India at this point of time. Some of this attack has to kind of settle down. And some of the sentiment has to come back, not just the consumption sentiment, but just the sentiment of feeling safe and feeling like investing. And I think we are a little far away from that destination at this point of time. So I dare say that we perhaps have to live on a single engine firing, a consumption engine firing, and perhaps a part of the second engine, which is the government expenditure, replacing part of the private investment. I'm not very optimistic that there is anything in this budget or indeed at this point of time in the ecosystem that encourages me to say that it's going to kickstart soon.
No, but then conversely, the question would be that has he done enough on the public expenditure and infrastructure side, 25% yes, that would benefit the economy in a good way, or do you believe he did the right thing by staying fiscally disciplined?
Well, you know, question is, did he have leeway to do a little more? Could he have been a little more liberal in not pursuing a fiscal deficit target of 3.2? He perhaps could have. My own view is that he's preferred to keep, you know, the global rating institutions a little happier. And my own view is that if he turns lucky and if he strikes two or three opportunities that are there in the budget, that are there in the marketplace. I mean, I said, you know, is he going to collect
a significantly large amount through this surgical operation that the government will undertake on money pushed through the banking system. Some of the points that Sajjid made earlier, I think if he gets more money in his pocket, there's no reason why he can't have. I know he's given away the concept of unplanned expenditure, but there's no reason why he can't have unplanned capital expenditure at some point of time. But I think trying to remain true to the fiscal deficit has been a wise decision. It's been well lauded, I think, by almost everybody I've heard on the television today.
Undoubtedly, for rating agencies that he doesn't pretty much like, nor his government likes, because yes, we see a constant battle going on
including
there.
Including
right?
The economic survey. Just, you know, on the supply side of the investment, so there in the economic survey, just coming to you from a banking standpoint, the argument, and Arvind Subramanian spoke to us and said that the argument is that at least try and ease up the supply side, create a bad bank. I mean, that's his suggestion, or if not, create a bad bank provision enough to get that bad loan problem moving, not sorted, but moving. That hasn't happened, Rajiv. I mean, from a banking sector, and I'm asking you as a representative of the sector, disappointment that we're just sort of chugging along on that, not doing anything.
I don't think the budget could have done too much as far as, sort of the bad loan problem is concerned. It is, you know,
you could have given a hint that you're moving towards some sort of a public asset reconstruction company.
I think the first step really there is that, yes, we will capitalize the public sector banks, and we will provide 10,000 crores today, but if there is more required, we will be able to find resources for that. I think itself is something that the market should be quite happy about. The resolution of the entire the bad loan problem, I think, is a lot more complex and not something that he would be able to deal with just through the budget. I think there's a lot of stuff that's happening through the RBI and has where the RBI has been working through this over the last few years, and that will continue.
So it's not crucial to getting the private investment cycle going, or it is crucial.
It is.
Take its own sweet time. There's nothing they can do to force.
Absolutely.
Force it to change faster.
Absolutely.
Okay. That's on the investment front. On the consumption front, Mr. Kanabar, thank you very much for joining us. He did sort of this generous move of halving the tax applicable on the lowest income bracket, which is 2.5 lakhs to 5 lakhs per annum. Of course, conversely, he also put in a new surcharge on those earning between 50 lakhs to 1 crore. So this is Robin Hood Giri, right? Take from the rich poor and give the poor a break. But so be it. Is that, in your mind, going to mean more money in the wallets of people and therefore a sort of increase in consumption, which can counter some of the effects that we've just been talking about right now?
It certainly is. How significant it is remains to be seen. But you're looking really at a situation where people who got income of maybe up to 4.5-5 lakhs of rupees, depending on the type of savings that they make, which of course takes away from what they can consume, but will have no tax liability at all, number one. And number two, he estimated a revenue loss of about 15,500 crores
on this account. Yeah,
15,500 crores. That's the number which he put on the table. And correspondingly, the surcharge which he's going to get is going to be about 18,000 crores.
So he's actually making money on all of this.
He's making money on that. So how much of this 15,000 crore will come back on a consumption spend remains to be seen. But that would be a very positive move, certainly.
You know, the world is against this whole, or the world is in favor of the tax the rich sentiment. So it's really tough to argue against it. But the crorepati tax was supposed to be one-off. It got institutionalized. Now they've said it's not just for crorepatis, it's for those who have 50 lakhs to 1 crore, and they put in an additional surcharge.
And they've also done one other small little thing, which is to say that it's dividends received by individuals, which was earlier liable to the 10%.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now we have gone on to say it's not just that, but it's really received by anybody other than a company. So really it's expanding that net.
So partnerships, etc., etc.
Everybody
is
trust,
exposed to this.
Trust
partnerships.
Trust.
All
trust was really the most important target out there.
Okay. Trust me.
I think that's I don't know how much he's going to get in this consumption boost in any fashion.
I don't think there's anything which has been specifically budgeted at all. But I would expect that he believes that out of this 15,500 crores, bulk will get back to consumption.
Okay. What he didn't do in taxes is cut the headline corporate tax rate for large corporations. He did it for small corporations, yeah? And he cut it from 30 to 25%. Has corporate India felt a little left out of this budget this year? Because you didn't get the corporate tax rate that you were expecting to get, the corporate tax rate cut. you are going to see the deductions and exemptions start going away from this year itself.
Yeah.
You didn't quite get anything that, you know, made you feel that private investment will come back. So, you know, you were the child in the corner.
Yeah. Not exactly. We are supposed to be the adults who have to look after themselves.
Okay.
And the children were being looked after.
Okay, fair enough.
So, but just to get in, so who are we to argue when 96% of the served population is now getting the benefit of tax? But
you're talking about the small corporations, and you're talking with tongue firmly in cheek.
No, tongue firmly in the mouth.
Okay.
So no, but the 4%, which is us, actually what has happened over a period of time, like you rightly said, the exemptions have gone.
Some of them have gone. Accelerated depreciation, so, SEZs, yeah. They all start falling off April 1st this year.
Absolutely. And the earlier one, what had fallen was what are the deductions not available, etc. So I saw some of the places the tax rate go as high as 34%. Okay. The effective rates is nowhere close to 25 today, much higher than that. So clearly there is a negative from that point of view. But like you said, if you're a Robin Hood, or if you're a father trying to manage, you've got to cut somewhere. And at the end of the day, if 3.2, which itself you'll argue, is there, then you have to balance the budget. So they at least the rich. And now you said we can't argue against that, right?
No, but I must say, you can argue all you want. If he's Robin Hood, you're Braveheart. I want to know if Mr. Shankaraman is taking it on the chin as well.
I think there is one thing to be said about it. If the spend, whether in rural, let's say 24% of the increase in rural development, yeah, various initiatives that are put. So, and this results in consumption and productive assets that is being brought by, let's say, the entire rural population. Is there a top line possibility versus no relief on the, say, tax rate?
I had the same conversation with you last year, same time, right?
Yeah.
It didn't quite go the way you had hoped it would.
I think we'll have to look at the results to say, and I have a memory loss on and off. But I think the overall economy, and honestly, I want to kind of back off and say this about it. Just look at this world today. Nobody can predict what's happening around the world, whether in US or in Italy or in Europe or Brexit, whatever. So it's a turmoil world. And we have kind of negated with 7% growth. There's something to be said for things working. You know, we can always bargain, should it have been 9? But what if it should have been 5? So there is some merit to say
we shouldn't be. I don't think we're taking away from the merit in a disciplined budget, the merit in still being able to increase infrastructure spends, the merit in making the effort to expand the tax base, which we haven't seen in many years this country, right? So I think there is great merit in all of that. But are you still feeling left out, Mr. Shankaraman? Because you didn't quite get Mr. Jaitley for 2 years in his budget speeches has been promising that tax rate, headline tax rate cut, right? And it hasn't come through.
Yeah, I mean, you'll have to get philosophical, all good things take time. But having said that, the corporate India is battling with two aspects. One is the promised reduction not coming through. Possibly the size is becoming a disadvantage in this context.
Yes.
The second part is I wouldn't mind this delay so long as tax administration improves. The amount of money locked up in litigations, the time that are taken in refunds is no joke. Now, if the government were to compensate the delayed dispensation of reduced tax rate, were to expedite some of these dispute resolution, it could go a long way. Because today it's a double whammy.
You had an amnesty scheme. You should have taken advantage of it.
No, it's a question of legitimate.
There were three amnesty schemes in the last 16 months.
Yeah,
right?
But the question of legitimate disputes. I mean, we're talking about corporate India where under proper legal tax advice, interpretations are taken, stances are taken, and questions are asked. And generally, the experience has always been the taxman errs on the side of revenue, at the first instance. So you have to go through the appeals and the appellate tribunals and to courts if required. And there's a tremendous amount of cases that are pending. So I would like to stay with delayed justice if that be it, but I need a compromise in terms of faster dispensation of the refunds and the litigations.
I don't think anybody here can promise you that. Mr. Kanabar, I know you want to jump in, but when you jump in, please also answer this question. Does this mean that next year he does a 5% cut in the corporate tax rate? For large corporations?
It is also the point I was trying to make that, so to the point which Shankar Raman was making, really, it was not an open-ended thing when he said that he's going to reduce the rate of tax. He said, by March 18, I will do it.
Correct. Yeah.
Therefore, we have just next year to live with that 5%. But what got me a little bit thinking was that today, as I was watching the economic advisor and the finance secretary talk about and question about this very same thing, their answer was, yeah, we did tell you that we will reduce the rate of tax, but we didn't tell you it will be for everybody. So we have reduced it last year for new manufacturing companies.
Correct.
This year we reduced for small, but we never told you that it is applicable for everybody. So really it got me thinking. I mean, I was actually being incredulous to say, am I hearing what am I hearing?
Wow. I don't have an explanation. I think maybe they've just changed their promise.
No. So to be fair, the finance minister never said, for all corporates, I'm going to reduce it, I'm going to reduce the headline rate. But
to be
25,
fair, the finance minister didn't quite say he's going to do it only for a few corporates
absolutely.
Either.
No,
right?
I didn't.
I was just responding
to your point that do we expect a 5% reduction next year? And I would have thought that is what it ought to be, but that's not what it seems like, because we just heard to say maybe that's not the issue.
There was another tag to that same conversation that Dinesh is referring to, which is where they sort of said, look, we've looked at effective tax rates. And in the group that we have given the benefit, we think the effective tax rate is about 30. However, in the group, which is, let's say, the 4%, we find that, as per our calculation, the effective tax rate is around 24, 25.
Okay.
And from that perspective, it sort of seems to be that what we had said, if one wants elbow room, is that we will bring everybody to that effective tax rate. Was that word ever used? Was that ever the orientation? No. But, you know, those were the sort of two sub-themes which came through from there. The other bit, just to sort of respond on, you know, this long ongoing issue in terms of tax administration, interpretation, the logjam in the system from the legal perspective. What you are sort of effectively finding is that, you know, when you have a situation where you have policy, and then policy and administration we know are two completely different things. And then you have situations where you have administrative circular after administrative circular, 30, 40 in a year, what is it actually showing you? That between whatever you set out to do in the budget and between what happens on the ground, there is so much which effectively happens, which I think goes in two boxes. There is a generic box, which is litigation. And then from that, you carve out some stuff, which you try and explain away through circulars. But all of it ultimately has a genus in terms of a complete lack of orientation in administration in terms of whatever may be your policy. That is a matter of DNA. That is something that they have charter after charter on, but we are not getting that. So, you know, when industry says, fix what you can fix, I don't think you can fix tax administration. Not in the next 12 months. You are leaving it increasingly to the judiciary. And, you know, significantly in the Supreme Court, there's no dedicated tax bench.
I know, unfortunately. Yeah. The one year there was a bench, it did well, which did fantastic stuff.
Yeah. And, you know, now we don't have that focus. So the situation is administration remains where it is. You choose not to sort of give the benefits, which is fine because that's completely, you know, within your domain. But this quid pro quo, that I don't mind living with this tax rate if you give me better administration, that isn't happening in a hurry. And if therefore you're aggrieved, call it out, you're aggrieved.
No, then they're not going to call it out. They're still going to be hopeful and they're not going to get the 5% cut next year either, because they're not small corporations.
There is also a subtext here. So to say that, listen, there are two interpretations, one which the administrator has and one the company has. Suppose what happens in level one or level two, there is a win on one side. And then because you can't just write off in an administrative area, you've got to appeal till you go through the entire cycle. This is something there can be real hope to say, and this finance minister did make that statement that we're going to see whether we can cut down on the kind of re-appeals that we have on so-called cases where the case itself may not be strong. So at least certainly that area we can have some.
I owe Rajiv an apology and Hira an apology. Because suddenly this went from being a budget 2017 conversation to a tax litigation.
But the budget is about
tax litigation. So sincere apologies, Rajiv.
So just to add one thing to that. That threshold below which it is fine for an officer not to go is a crore of rupees in indirect taxes. At crore of rupees, translate into a international budget, and you're talking to somebody to say that you're a company of the size you are, every day's tax, if interpretationally there is a divergence, is $200,000, and the limit at which they will draw the line is $200,000. So if you have more than one day of dispute, it's going to the Supreme Court.
No, I'm not smiling because I disagree or I'm mocking of the pain here, but it just seems like this is the nth year we are discussing this and there still seems to be no solution in sight. And you spoke of circulars, but Rohan, nowadays even FAQs are creating great amount of distress. That Section 9 FAQ on indirect transfers created so much panic amongst foreign portfolio investors, foreign investors of all kinds. Needlessly, you know.
So one issue I'll just say, which is directly related to the budget as opposed to the philosophical debate on taxes, is that we came to a situation where we said that the lesser the discretion available to tax authorities, the better we are. Because that's one of the issues where the administration and there are three provisions in this budget wherein an incremental discretion has been granted. And I'm sure these are fine prints which not very many people have spoken about.
Sure.
First is a right of an officer to call for information for no rhyme or reason, meaning there is nothing pending, but I need some information. That could have been called for only in a situation where a commissioner approved it, a principal commissioner. That was a safeguard built in. So first it was felt that you can call for information only when there is something pending, not generally, not for a phishing inquiry. The law was amended to say they could call for information generally. However, the safeguard is principal commissioner has to approve.
Right.
And this year they said nobody needs to approve, even the lowest officer can call for information.
Number one.
Number two. We are aware of raids and what happens in the course of a raid, and I have no sympathy for people who don't pay taxes. But one of the things which hears in a raid is coercion and forced declaration. We now have a provision this year to say that if in the course of a raid an officer believes it's right to do so, he can provisionally attach properties.
Oh, really?
And if he can do that, you can understand how much can he force a declaration.
Wow.
So we are looking at a number of things.
Number three?
It just escaped me to come back.
Was it the 6-year, 10-year thing? Because now I think they've also allowed you to go back and open books, not just for 6 or 7 years.
No, that was not the issue. There's a third one.
But when you think of it, please do let us know. I think both those last 2 points of fine print missed us altogether.
It's just amazing on what happened.
Okay, since we're talking.
I've changed my mind, so I want the 5% reduction.
I think we're still focused on intent on my left hand side, so we'll talk about content in just a bit. But honestly, on tax, there were a couple of more things I wanted to quickly run by both of you gentlemen. I think there are some changes in transfer pricing. I won't get into it in great amount of detail. Thin capitalization rules have been brought in. We spoke of the surcharge and the changes in income tax, indirect transfers. I think, do you believe, or can you take us through what you think the net outcome of these changes are? So for instance, the clarification on indirect transfers, are foreign investors now at peace?
So first, you mentioned about transfer pricing. Good news, domestic transfer pricing is gone. So today we have domestic transfer pricing where related parties, if they deal with each other, both are paying taxes, why do you want transfer pricing? So now, unless one of the party is getting a tax concession, there is no domestic transfer pricing. So the likes of Mahindra, the likes of L&Ts who have got multiple entities, breathe sigh of relief. Good measurement. FIIs, very the
this is the Section 9 indirect transfer.
Section 9. Very, very welcome. Basic proposition, they have not increased the threshold of 5% and all of that.
Correct.
But what they have provided is really, if you are an FII category 1 or 2, then
the
in respect AIF of
rules,
that. And if any investment is coming from overseas, which is redeemed as a consequence of a disposition in India, then there is no second taxation out there. Very, very welcome.
Okay. And the third one I want to talk about was thin capitalization rules. I know for many years we've been talking about introducing them. I think they've come through now.
They've come through in a very, very limited manner.
Okay.
Not too much of concern really. So the provision is that if your interest deduction is more than 30% of your EBITDA, and it is in respect of interest which you have paid to an associated enterprise, meaning a related party overseas,
right,
then the deduction is restricted to 30%.
Okay.
So a normal interest deduction is not a challenge, and I would suspect there will be very, very few people who would be covered by the thin capitalization rule. It's consistent with the OECD recommendation and not something I would be worried about, because even the interest which is not allowed as a deduction can be carried forward for the next years.
Okay. Yeah, you have 8 years, which you can still carry.
One can complain about tax, but you've got to give Finance Minister Arun Jaitley credit for the fact that he didn't tinker with indirect taxes this time at all. Yeah. He said, look, I know GST is on the way. I'm not increasing service tax. I'm not increasing excise. I'm not doing anything. He just made some changes in customs and excise to boost Make in India. I think mostly to do with inverted duty structures, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So the situation is, you know, full marks there, because you are literally a few months away. And, you know, you don't want people in turmoil for sort of the interim. There was expectation that certain exempted items, which will at least move to 5%, you know, he will do something. But I am saying sort of hats off, you know, yes, he must have had the temptation, and the biggest temptation would have been to correct the service tax rate,
yeah,
and therefore take it to 18. But I
mean,
think
taking it to 18 without input credit would have not been fair.
But
right?
Yeah, so they were sagacious in terms of saying you still don't get VAT-related credit. And to the extent that you don't get VAT-related credit, it's not merited. Nor has he sort of fed anything to further fodder the situation of two service tax rates, etc. So all in, I think, you know, just to be complimented for doing nothing, and, you know, in an exercise of this sort, that's a huge achievement.
Yeah, Ira, I promise you, I'm done with
no,
tax.
No, I think we're all done with
tax. With one quick last comment. This is the first budget in many years that I haven't seen him read out for 20 minutes an endless list of items, where he will be then saying CVD down by 2%, excise up by 3%, and it was refreshing. And I hope this is the way budgets will go from here on.
It was there in the fine print.
Which is why analysts probably don't have, you know, much to do today, because, you know, this
there was some of it in the fine print, you're right, but not as much as most years.
But, you know, that day probably is coming on the 1st of April. Once the classification for GST is settled and the basketing of rates is done, he will have to engage with what goes where and why.
Okay, I'm done with tax. Last couple of things.
And, you know, I guess, you know, we've talked about some of the minutiae, some of the singers, sectors that have been in focus. What was there in the budget that you thought was big bang or not big bang enough? I mean, you know, there are some issues we don't have time to discuss, like political funding, FIPB, etc., which are big reforms. There are some which are not, which you've already said, but, you know, bad bank, or actually even taking the whole cashless economy forward. They haven't done anything.
Enough.
I
think it's an intent thing.
So no,
for
banking,
me,
cash transaction tax.
Fiscal consolidation,
that,
I think, is, you know, was big. Two is the whole issue around digital payments. I think it is really, in a sense, a movement. I mean, don't look at it as at a point in time. I think, you know, look at it, you know, from where we're coming through in terms of demonetization. And I think three for us is affordable housing.
So I would think of it as fundamentals first. That's what this budget, it carried forward everything that they talked about last year. Deeper, maybe a little larger, and in some cases a little smaller. So in a sense, if you ask, it's like what I thought about was Southwest Airlines. You know, many things that you do which create magic, not one thing. So if you add up all this and say there will be some implementation on this, this could create magic, because the discipline is there, the consumption input is there, and if part of the consumption story or investment story in infrastructure is to be implemented, then it's like the Southwest Airlines. So you can say for the first time the government is implementing activity fit to strategy in budgeting.
Your analogies are fabulous. Yeah. I think
you must go back to Mr. Parthasarathy right at the end, because I do know he has a couplet prepared that will describe the budget most appropriately.
Okay, then we let Mr. Shankar Raman go and
also I want to add to Ira's question. Has he done enough to help protect Indian enterprise from all the global headwinds, the Trump protectionism, everything else that's going on across the world?
I don't think so, because I think one big piece that has got missed out is manufacturing. See, we did speak about clean India, digital India, skill India, all of that.
Stand up
but
India.
What happened to make in India? Nothing has happened. So to my mind, I don't know why the government has thought not fit to address the manufacturing competency. See, when you have the whole world turning inward and protectionism becomes a key theme, you need to look at your own domestic market and protect it yourself. So India has a large advantage there. It has a market waiting to consume. So competitive manufacturing, be it sustained cheap power or steady flow of labor. The budget did talk about conducive labor environment. But
and
it,
labor reform.
I don't know what it meant, because today to battle with separation on economic grounds is not easy. The unions are never the same as they were 20 years ago, but still is an effort. And the government does play agony aunt when it comes to these kind of issues. So I'm surprised that manufacturing has been discounted. The need, the requirements that need to make manufacturing competitive, to wait for the consumption fillip to be able to consume our goods.
What would you like to see?
See, I think there has to be an audit of what we are good at. Currency is going to have headwinds in terms of, because of all that's happening around. So you need to protect your dollars and sit on it. So you need to spend in rupee as much as you can. So you need to force the market to look at internal options. Now, you can't force the consumer to buy costly just because of all these factors. So you need to make it affordable for the consumer. So be it in terms, I mean, I hope GST will make things more competitive
eventually.
But there are these issues about ability to move factories from place to place. And we know out of our own experience, to move factory from a high-cost zone to a low-cost zone is not easy at all. Government needs to play the facilitation role. Talking about PPP, now a lot of people did believe the government and went into the PPP, but they're at the high end of the spectrum today. They're left to defend for themselves on whatever is happening. The hand-holding is not adequately happening. That possibly is the reason why PPP has not got much of a mention in this. But the fact is there are people hurt, and that needs to be done. So some of those aspects, I think unless you're addressed, you're not going to have a big bang budget. According to me, the big bang would be on how you implement what you have announced. And if he doesn't shift the goalposts and try to stick to what he has announced, I think that will be a big credibility win for him moving into the next budget.
Rohan, last word to you. Actually, second last word. Couplet, not last couplet for sure.
Yeah. No, I think there is, you know, much to compliment. And at the same time, I guess all of us feel so passionately about, you know, the things which should get done and somehow expect all of them to happen in the budget, that there's always going to be something to comment. But my mind, you know, the one situation is he has done nobody any real harm. He's allowed you to effectively live through your instincts, which are competitive, entrepreneurial, and said, look, we are here as government, we'll play our role, okay? And I think sometimes that is a lot in terms of, you know, saying that we are a 7% nation. Yes, we could do more, we could expect more, but nothing has set us back. And that in itself is sometimes a blessing.
Wow, we're now measuring budgets by how little they set us back. I don't know what else to say except to actually give you the last word here.
So just to kind of say that there have been many hits in this budget and some misses, but it's a time to believe, and as Menaka would want me to say, thoda hai, thode ki zarurat hai, zindagi yahan phir bhi khoobsurat hai. So that's what.
All right, that's what. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
With that, we're going to wrap it up here on Bloomberg Quint.